Okay, fine. So, you know, the fireworks are over. I think Ajit and Varun finished it, so I have to do the mopping part of it. So you're going to be bombarded with a lot of details about what we learned from these two coincident two events. Okay, so I, you know, the talk I'm going to base myself is on a paper that that is written jointly with LIGO, Fermi, and Integral. But you know, a lot of parts of that is too technical. So I would, you know, I would like to explain to you that what did we learn about the gamma ray burst, the GRB170817A, from the associated gravitational wave event, which is again GW170817. The A comes because there was two GRBs on the same day, and you know, that's why I wanted to give an A there. Okay, so with that, you know, so the top stories is that, you know, like Ajit and Varun said, we now know that the binary neutron star mergers can produce short gamma ray burst. The converse is not clear, whether they are the only ones or the other thing can produce, still don't know, we have to wait, but that is one thing. And I'm going to talk about the other thing, about the direct evidence for off-axis jet. So I'll come to what I mean by off-axis jet. And again, Varun talked about kilonova, so I will not talk much about it because and I won't have time. And the rest of the talk is going to be about the, you know, the real physics that we learned or we hope to learn in future with such observations. That is what is going to be the theme. Okay. So just a quick thing, you know, with a kind of broad audience. So gamma ray bursts are like the most energetic explosions after the Big Bang, and you know, they are bursts of gamma rays, and we saw afterglows or in the lower frequencies from X-ray all the way up to radio for various bursts. And in order to explain the energy and various features and variability and so on, it is almost certain that they have to be highly collimated jet with ultra-relativistic velocity. You know, the kind of things are moving at ultra-relativistic speed, typically Lorentz factor of the order of hundreds. That is the kind of basic picture that we have about gamma ray burst. And now this model, which talks about this thing, does not require to know what is producing it. You need a lot of energy pumped into a small area, and then you just launch the jet. But what produces the jet itself is not completely known. So, but the best model or the simplest thing that you can cook up is to have a black hole plus an accretion disk, which launches the jet, which of course can be, you know, there may be various variants of that, which could explain the same. But the basically black hole plus disk, accretion disk launching a jet with a highly collimated ultra-relativist thing is what is the basic picture behind the gamma ray burst. Okay, so now the typical energies that are released during the burst is roughly 10 raised to 49 to 10 raised to 53 ergs, which makes it the most energetic explosion. These numbers are important because the one which I'm going to talk about, you will see how different it is from this typical number. So this is all typical thing. I not talked about anything else about a specific kind of burst and so on. So with that thing, so this again is what is called fireball model, which is where it starts. You know, if you have a lot of energy into a small area, you just let it launch the jet. All the features about this jet, highly collimated, ultra-relativist jet, can be explained by what is called the fireball model. And this tells you that there are internal shocks between various shock fronts, which gives you the prompt emission, that is the gamma ray emission. As this jet is going through the interstellar medium, it loses energy. It starts, you know, there are external shocks it produces on the ambient medium. And this produces the lower emissions, starting from X-ray all the way up to radio. So that is basically internal shocks produce the gamma ray burst, and the external shocks produce the afterglows in various bands. And you know, this depending upon the situation, we have seen almost everything up to radio, as I said, so all low frequencies. Okay, so now this is an old picture from Batse, which made a histogram of the various gamma ray bursts it detected. So the left plot shows that, you know, this is a plot of the time of the burst. So time, and I mean, this is a time in which 90% of the total energy was emitted. So that is, there's a bimodality in the distribution of the duration of the burst. And this bimodality has a, you know, kind of sharp thing at two seconds. On the left, you call it short duration burst, and on the right, you call it long duration burst. This picture, you know, this Batse is one of the old ones in the gamma rays. Things have changed after Swift. There are things which are on, you know, which sort of borders both of them and so on, but they have its own systematics and so on. But loosely still, people use the short hard burst versus long soft burst. So what I mean by hard and soft is this. This is a spectral hardness, which, you know, if you don't know, don't worry about it too much. But I think, you know, the fact is that the short bursts are seem to be spectrally hard as opposed to the long bursts, which are spectrally soft. So now, among the two categories, this is the long bursts are well studied. We have seen them happening. We have seen also supernova explosions happening with that. So these are massive stars which sort of explodes and gives out, forms a black hole plus a accretion disk and gives a jet. That is well understood because we have seen a lot of supernova explosions together with this long burst. The short bursts have been detected and they have been, their typical energies are lower and we cannot see them up to large distances. And they have been speculated to be due to either double neutron star mergers or neutron star black hole mergers until this event happened. That is where the standard, and again, so these are all standard things prior to this event. Okay, so this is probably the, you know, the kind of first instance where there was a concrete proposal saying that the double neutron star mergers, if you have two neutron stars, like the one you heard from Ajit's talk, they can give you an account for the kind of energies that you expect from this kind of gamma ray burst. This is a paper by Ramesh Narayan, Vachinsky and Sweepiran from 92, and you know, they just explain for how, you know, and how it can explain for the kind of energy and various features you require in the for the short gamma ray burst. And I'm sure that there have been talks about it earlier, because in the 1986 paper by Schutz, which Archishwan will talk about in the next one, he does mention about the possibility. So maybe the first concrete proposal as to how to explain various features and so on probably came from them. But you can see that in this abstract, you know, the last sentence reads that if this is indeed the scenario, you would expect the double neutron star mergers also to be seen in the LIGO band, because LIGO was probably proposed around that time or was more actively kind of taken up. So it's very interesting that this, you know, this paper was this paper had predicted the fact that double neutron star mergers can produce both the gamma ray burst and a gravitational wave signal in the LIGO band. Okay, so now what do we hope to? So if there are joint observations like the one we have, what kind of things do we want to learn from the thing? So there have been a lot of studies I just shown to this review. This is one of the work that I did. So basically, we want to understand what is the nature of the progenitor. Is it, you know, this is a double neutron star merger or something else and so on? Of course, ideally, I would also like to know what is the central engine, like Rajesh was asking. That's a bit a tough question to ask. But again, that is one of the things. Second thing is about the geometry of the jet. You know, was the jet directed towards you? Did I happen to be on the axis of the jet? Or were I away from the jet and I saw some different features and so on? That is something to be understood, would like to understand. Secondly, the structure of the jet. What I mean by structure of the jet is that was the quantities, for example, emissivity and the Clorentz factor within the cross-section of the jet, was it constant or uniform across the cross-section, or did it depend upon how I view it? So that is what I mean, structure of the jet. So I would like to understand what are the details of the structure of the jet. And I also want to estimate, for example, various parameters such as ambient number density of the ambient medium through which the external shock is propagating and so on. So these are the kind of interesting things that we would be interested in to understand fundamentally about these events. And these are the kind of there's a question we want to ask whenever there is a joint detection. Okay, so now coming back to, so Ajit explained the the gravitational wave part of it. So what you've got, so the basic picture I'm going to point out to you is the following. So you've got a two neutron star to merge. They form a black hole plus an accretion disk of some type, which launches a jet. Now, I mean, of course, details are, I mean, I'm not going to the kind of technical things such as the one which mentioned in the previous talk. But the idea is that if there is the jet is launched along the axis of the black hole that is formed, then you have information about the axis of the black hole from gravitational observation. This is because you know the angle between your line of sight and the orbit thing. This is an explicit quantity which comes in the polarization and hence in the gravitational waveform. And this iota or the I which comes here tells you about the orientation of the binary's orbit with respect to line of sight. This would eventually have become the total angular momentum direction of the newly formed black hole also. But you can see that this explicitly comes in the gravitational wave amplitude. Hence, seeing the wave, you would expect that you have some information about what is iota. But you will also see that the iota and distance, these quantities are strongly degenerate. So it is very difficult to lift this degeneracy. And hence, at least as far as gravitational observations alone are concerned, you need more detectors which can break this degeneracy because there is more information. So theta and phi are which characterize the location of the binary in the sky. Okay, so now if things are off axis, you know, things can be there. So this is actually, this is a paper by Troy et al., which I've taken. So this is the picture. You've got a black hole or something, this thing giving out a jet. And this jet is the black one. There is kilonova, which is the more isotropic emission, which goes out this. The blue one is something complicated. Don't bother about it. So this is the, I mean, as a function of theta v, which is the viewing angle. So you can be here, then you're on the axis of the jet. You can be slightly away, which will call you the theta v or the viewing angle, how you're viewing the jet. And theta j is the initial jet opening angle. It's just the semi-open angle of the jet. And these are the quantities which play an important role. So what is shown here is the prompt emission, the gamma ray emission, from what these people have done, within what is called a top hat jet model, where they assume that quantities across the jet cross-section are the same. It doesn't depend upon angle. It is, and things such as emissivity and so on does not vary across, I mean, as a function of the angle between the jet direction and the direction of the axis of the black hole. Now, so you can see that until, for example, theta v, you know, the if you have jet opening out of 10 to minus 2, until here it is all constant, there is nothing. But once you happen to be away from the axis of the jet, that is away from here, things, you know, the observed energy sort of sharply falls down. It's, you know, it can fall by several orders of magnitude if you are not viewing it on axis. So this is not unlikely that if you are not viewing the axis, GRB on axis, or you know, if you are happen to be away from the axis, your the isotropic energy that you will observe can be significantly suppressed with respect to the standard ones that you know. So that is something to be taken. So now you can ask, how would the afterglow modeling be affected? So this is, you know, it so happened that with Mohammed Salim of ICTS, we were actually carrying out this exercise about understanding things jointly. What more information can we get by doing this joint analysis? And so we were on the kind of a right frame of mind to jump onto the kind of things happen soon after. So this is actually a light curve, which is the X-ray light curve as a function of time, the flux as a function of time, X-ray and the radio light curves, about showing the difference between the on-axis and the off-axis. The off-axis scenarios. Off-axis, I've just said to be theta v is equal to 2 theta j, that is twice the angle, the jet opening angle. You can see that those features are quite different, and you know that would show that, you know, you would expect the exact features of the on-axis jet and off-axis jet to be considerably different. So now I come to the joint question, which was sort of mentioned. So we have got this this event, which of course I think Varun explained very nicely what the thing is. Again, you know, if you're hearing for the first time, this is the double neutron star. This is a frequency map of the double neutron star merger. As a function of time, the frequency chirps up because it is in spiraling. What is shown is the two Fermi, the low and the high gamma ray burst monitor light curve. And this integral, another one. So this is just shows you that around 2 seconds after the burst, there was a burst in the gamma ray burst after the merger sort of happened. So now there are a few important aspects about the whole things. It happened after two of them. You can also assign a false alarm probability, because using the temporal coincidence and the spatial coincidence, you can estimate what is the probability that it could be, you know, we could be wrong, and it is extremely small, 10 to minus 8, as, you know, based on the spatial and the temporal coincidence. And as Ajit said, it is the closest short gamma ray burst which has happened with known distance, like 40 megaparsec. And the most important thing is that it is dimmer by a factor of 2 to 6 orders of magnitude than typical short gamma ray burst. So if you saw that the lower energy thing was 10 raised to 49 ergs, this happened to be around 10 raised to 46, which is like 3 orders of magnitude lower. What it meant, as Arun said, is that the Fermi alone couldn't have localized it in the sky. So because it's weak, you know, it's like a sub-threshold kind of a thing in their notation. And also the fact that, you know, if it were of something of that sort, such a huge follow-up would not have been possible. So it was due to gravitational wave observation and its sky map that, you know, we knew there's a double neutron star merger. We knew probably this is going to be a short gamma ray burst, and then and a good sky map. So this all together led to a extensive follow-up of this event, is what we heard in detail in the previous talk. So these are the kind of important thing, and I'm going to focus mostly on the dimness and what, you know, what all that can be due to. Now we come to gravitational waves. As I told you that, you know, if it were off axis, or the viewing angle is actually we have, if we can estimate the inclination angle from gravitational observations, we do have a handle on theta v. So that is what we want to know. Can we independently of the electromagnetic observation, can we get some handle on the off axisness? And the answer is yes. So this is actually the inclination angle. So is the inclination angle the posterior on the cosine of the inclination angle, which is naturally what appears in the waveform, and hence that is what is used. And I'm sure that some variant of this will come in Archishman's talk next. So this shows you that, you know, so now there's a strong degeneracy between inclination angle and distance, but if you know the redshift, as it is the case with this event from the optical observations, then you can use the redshift and the cosmological model and then estimate what is iota. That's a stronger constraint, because if you consider only gravitational waves, this curve's very kind of broad constraint. But if you, for example, use the Hubble constant value from the supernova experiment, you do get a posterior which is quite narrow. And this is the one for the Planck and so on. So if you invoke the redshift and use the distance using a Hubble constant, then you can estimate theta v, which is like you take it to minimum of the iota and 1 minus, 80 minus iota. It just shows you the kind of helicity of the orbit, that's all. So that indeed shows that, you know, if you convert typically this into the kind of numbers, you will get it to be 40 into 32 or something is the number that you will get, for at least for this orange curve. So that indeed means that the inclination angle is consistent with kind of off-axisness. And we would like to know that whether did we see features of the same type in the electromagnetic follow-ups also. So again, you know, as this, all the electromagnetic follow-up papers came out just the next day, I had to admit that I had not gone over all the papers very carefully. So I'm going to explain to you some of the broader features which are consistent with this with the off-axis hypothesis. Okay. So I think the first prediction that you would expect is that it's a weak prompt emission because you're off-axis, like we said in the previous plot. Then indeed here it happened to be 2 to 6 orders of magnitude lower than the typical one. And it would also lead to weak and late X-ray emission, which was, of course, true. Swift and so on could not detect the X-ray. It needed Chandra to detect it, that too after 9 days. And it indeed detected radio detection with the JVLA, the Jansky Very Large Array kind of array telescope. So the important thing here is that such bursts have been seen. And Fermi has many subthreshold events, but the problem with those subthreshold events is that you do not know whether it's a burst at a high, I mean, it's a usual burst at a faraway distance or something which is faint at a close by distance. So here, since we knew the gravitational wave told you that it has to be at 40 or 50 megaparsec, it has to be close by. So this, you know, then you have to explain why it is dim despite being so close. This is why it is important. And, you know, this is one way of explaining it is to invoke the off-axisness, which seems to be consistent both from the gravitational wave point of view as well as from the point of view of the electromagnetic thing that you see. Okay, so now the next thing, I want to go to the structure of the jet. So we want to address questions such as, can we kind of understand the jet profile in more detail with this observation or in, you know, or with future observations? And the big problem in understanding this is this parameter space. So you have got redshift, you've got theta v, theta j, these are the jet opening angle and viewing angle, isotropic energy, this is the Lorentz factor, then this is energy which goes into the, you know, from the contribution for the electric and the magnetic field, and this is a number density. So it's a huge parameter space, and especially between this theta v, theta j, EI, so and gamma, there is strong degeneracy. So if you use the data and try to start getting posteriors, multi-dimensional posteriors, you'll see that, you know, you get posteriors which are very sharply peaked with a long tail. So there is a lot of strong correlation, and your bounds, 90% bounds are going to be quite spread out. So it may not yield you any useful constraint. So just to tell you the two, like I said earlier, you've got a uniform jet model and the structured jet model. So structured jet model is something where you've got a core here, and you've got an angular dependence beyond that core. So you may think of it like a Gaussian kind of a profile or something where there is some width, and after that it sort of spread out. That is one model involved. But, you know, if you want to eventually distinguish between the top hat jet model and the structured jet model, it is quite difficult, at least with just one observation. But in future, you do hope to get a better handle on the jet profile. It is also true that the top hat jet model is very widely used, or the uniform jet model is very widely used in all GRB modeling, and it is well developed. You know, we know everything about it. But structured jet is not, you know, as developed, because there was no reason to invoke structured jet, because, you know, with the electromagnetic observations alone, you cannot even say something is off-axis or not. So I'm sure that after this event, it is going to invoke a lot of interest and a lot of development, theoretical development towards understanding the structured jet. So in future also, you know, to understand this, gravitational observations are going to play a very crucial role. But you know, I would say with this event, we cannot make one statement or other, or even talk too much about the jet profile. It is consistent with both of them. Okay. So now, what do you hope to see in the future? So this again is a, you know, this comes from one, you know, one detection and fitting a gamma ray burst. So gamma ray burst luminosity function on the lower end and so on. There are a lot of uncertainties, but what it tells you is that the binary neutron star rate, you know, typically in the O3, that is the next observation run that will happen, could be between 1 to 50, and with design sensitivity with advanced LIGO, it could be 6 to 120 in a year. This is something in a year. But the joint one, that is LIGO, LIGO Virgo plus the Fermi GBM, could be between up to 1.4 in this case, and up to 1.7. But this, you know, these estimates are uses what is called a luminosity function of the short gamma ray burst, and it is, you know, it's sort of edgy. It's not, there are a lot of error bars with that, which will have to be quantified later. This is like a preliminary estimate about what you hope to see. So now, about the future. So what do you hope to see in the future? Like I said, the first thing will be understanding the central engine. Can we say anything, either from electromagnetic observations like Varun was mentioning, or by using the, you know, the gravitational signature like ring down, which was which came up for discussion earlier. Can we understand what is causing? Is it a hypermassive neutron star? Did it collapse to a black hole, or what was exactly happening? That is one open problem which we would like to understand in future. And again, the jet structure, as I told you, one would need to have more sources and more a lot more theoretical development towards understanding it. And the other thing is, of course, that, you know, we have seen double neutron star producing a short gamma ray burst. Can neutron star black hole mergers produce a gamma ray burst? You know, they have been proposals that in principle it can, but, you know, I mean, how different will they be from the usual one? So can we detect, of course, we have to detect a neutron star black hole first, which we have not said so far. And in future, you know, I'm maybe too optimistic about a neutron observation, but, you know, from the kind of estimates, it may have to be very close by, which may not happen. But even then it is, of course, you know, gravitational wave plus EM plus neutron is like an ultimate picture that we can hope to have. So this is the kind of broad things which we are looking forward to. So I'll conclude this last slide. So there is a, you know, in this joint paper, there is a dedication to Neil Geras, who is no more with us, and who played a big role in sort of bringing this electromagnetic and the gamma ray community and gravitational community together. And you know, this is an acknowledgement to him, and I want to stop this stop here with that acknowledgement. Thank you.
Thanks, Arun. I have two questions. First of all, I would imagine that polarization studies of this event might have given some indication also to the kind of asphericity that's to be expected, and therefore the extent of the crack.
You mean gamma ray polarization studies?
No. Well, polarization studies, yes, in gamma ray as well as in optical. I believe there have been some papers on the polarization studies.
Yeah, sure. I mean, as I said, you know, I just got time to read the LIGO papers. I did not get time to read any of the other papers, so I don't know, unfortunately, but there should be something. But
do they match up? I was just wondering, but since you're obviously, you know, I was wondering whether the polarization studies match predicted an opening angle which was similar to that.
Yeah, I don't know.
The other thing is, you said that the Fermi had previously detected several short duration gamma ray bursts, but the problem was that they couldn't tell the distance. Okay. Now, if you have a neutron star merger, it's obviously going to be associated with some background galaxy.
Yes.
So I would imagine that if the Fermi observations had been correlated with existing surveys, they would have picked up a background galaxy already. I'm a bit surprised that it's just the distance which caused trouble with the Fermi interpretation.
No, sorry, I don't understand. So,
You have to have a background host galaxy, right?
Yes.
And if Fermi has picked up something and localized it to a certain region of the sky, you can pick, and you've seen the afterglow, you already picked up the host galaxy and you know what the distance is.
Yeah, but I think the Fermi, the sky map was so huge, you know, it was a weak burst and the sky map.
You pick up the optical afterglow, don't you end up identifying the host?
Yeah, sure, yeah.
So then you would. Presumably, even in the case of the Fermi gamma ray burst, you would actually have seen gamma ray bursts which are being seen off axis from the opening angle.
Yes, but I'm saying that, but I think then of course you have to restrict to those samples of the short gamma ray bursts where redshift is known.
But
I think, you know, but there aren't too many of them, or there aren't there within the error bars. I don't think there are too many which motivates one to look into that. But for the long gamma ray bursts, it is true that there have been a lot of at least Grano and so on, 2002 had proposed this model long ago, saying that off axis. But mostly for long, I have not seen any anything based on Fermi detection, which motivates off-axis for short gamma ray burst. Oh. But long gamma ray burst, there have been cases, to be fair.
Thanks.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
So the electromagnetic spectrum that comes from the merging of these two bodies, actually, it should have some dependency on their magnetic field. On their magnetic field.
Yeah.
So from such observation, one is the black hole and the neutron star. The electromagnetic spectrum observation, actually, whether we are in a position to tell that whether the black hole has a magnetic field or not.
No, black hole cannot have a magnetic
field.
The central engine.
There is some suspicious part, actually. Like, suppose between the two neutron star, the electromagnetic, both are having the magnetic field.
Yes.
The electromagnetic spectrum could be different compared to the black hole and the neutron star merging.
Yeah, sure. But I think then we need a expression for the flux, let's say. If you are talking about a highly magnetized star, compact star, giving out the thing, if you have an expression for the flux related to that, one can probably bound it, if that can explain all the standard features of gamma ray burst, and if it is magnetic field, you may be able to constrain that. But without a concrete model,
explains model
that, it is difficult to bound.
Yeah.
So in principle, yes, I agree with you, that if there is a thing, it should be possible.
Yeah. I have a comment and a question. The comment is on Firoza's question. So it is true that in the LIGO-Virgo collaboration, we did undertake an exercise of checking for coincident events or sub-threshold candidates between Fermi's GRBs and gravitational wave candidates in our data. But I think since the beginning of that exercise, we got flooded by low-hanging fruit, stronger signals, so that sort of offset that. But maybe there is now a case to return to this, O2 has ended.
Go back and see their past threshold triggers, and see some other thing. I'm sure that there'll be some studies of that sort.
Yeah, and the question I have is that given that this guy, GW170817, has very likely a pretty wide angle for the jet, it has implications purely from the GRB side on binary neutron star events that we could see, right? The rates you gave on the penultimate slide, do they actually incorporate that? Because in the past, you remember, Soderberg and others had obtained such estimates. Even Sweep Iran, with his alternative model, had different set of estimates for binary neutron star coalescences.
Yeah, so are you asking about how consistent is our independent BNS estimate from an estimate that will, that's solely based on short gamma ray burst?
Yes.
Yeah, I think,
To give a context, just looking at the the SGRB rates, the prediction was that we shouldn't see more than 10 gravitational wave, BNS events in A-LIGO 1 year.
Yeah, so I think, I'm sure from the email list that such estimates have been done, but I did not see anything reported in any of the papers. The one which I reported here is based on luminosity function, which again depends on the beaming and so on. So that is what I quoted. But I'm sure that, using the BNS, using a typical distribution for theta j, and getting the right estimates and consistency has been done. But I don't remember the numbers, and it's not reported anywhere that I can tell you.
Rahul? So there is an online question. Gurudat is asking, does this observation of short GRB from BNS in any way can rule out the emission of short GRBs from binary black holes? Or maybe we can put an upper limit?
No, but binary black holes, you have to observe binary black holes kind of separately, because we can see that after the follow-up of the first event where there was a candidate Fermi thing in association, we put some constraints and so on, but eventually the association was so weak that we couldn't say anything. But this one I don't think has any implications for a gamma ray burst from the BBH events.
And I have a question. So you said that this event was much dimmer than the typical short GRBs. So this could be also because of the two independent regions, because of the model of the beaming of the gamma ray, or because of the off-axis jet, as you said.
Yes.
But the reprocessing of the gamma rays is because of the length and heights, or our ignorance of the opacities. Do we have any...
No, I think so. That is what, for example, from the previous talk, one can invoke the way in which jet is launched and so on to explain also. So I think as of now, there is one cannot pick one for the other. But these are all candidate explanations. One has to see what we see in the future to really settle the thing. But you know, one will have to do a more systematic thing. Even here, you know, to do a very systematic thing about asking about the gamma, the Lorentz factor. If you do fault in every observation, you do find that there's a strongly correlated parameter space. You cannot really make very concrete statements on these things. So these are, with this uncertainty, I think this all models will have to be around, and then, you know, with future probably we can zero in on something more on the other.
One thing I just want to mention that like detailed spectral modeling in different bands would be like very useful, because the spectra, using the spectra, you can say even if you are looking at the off axis or, you know, or in the axis, the spectra will tell you very like concretely like what kind of you know jet structure do we have, or what kind of material is distributed, especially with respect to different elements. And So
you're saying that the typical gamma ray afterglow thing would have given us information about the jet structure already. Is that what you're?
So like detailed radiative transfer calculations and like in different bands, you know. Right?
Yeah, I think those calculations are not as complete as you want. For example, the one which I showed, my plot is on, that is on based on a numerical MSD code, which sort of does it. So these models are all got subtlety, so it's on. So I mean, I'm not an expert in that either, but I'm sure that, you know, yeah, I mean, it may be doable, but I don't know the details of it.
Okay, thank you.
I think let's sort of move on. So thank Arun again.